Good deal. Good evening, everybody. We're going to open with What a Friend We Have in Jesus. We'll sing the first and last verse of that. If you would, why don't you stand for us, please? What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry all our sins and griefs through prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Are we weak and heavy laden, covered with a load of our refuge, take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends invite and take thee, take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee. Thou find a soul is there.
You may be seated. Welcome back to Gillsburg on this Sunday evening. It's good to see everybody this morning, this evening. Goodness. Y'all are kind of, it was a little roar coming from behind me while I was sitting there. So y'all are a little spunky tonight, sounds like. So that's good. We welcome you back to Gillsburg. If you're watching us on YouTube or Facebook or sitting here in person, we appreciate your faithfulness. A few quick announcements. I want to remind everyone that Women on Mission will meet tomorrow at 1 o'clock. Tomorrow at 1 o'clock, Women on Missions. Remember our midweek activities beginning at 5:30 with supper. Put down on your calendar November the 19th at 5:30. That will be our Thanksgiving service and fellowship. I know that you'll want to be here for that. And then a reminder about Samaritan Purse shoe boxes. Some were taken this morning, so it looks like we got 11 or 12 left to get our goal. If you fill it out online, please let Miss Brenda know so we can count those boxes towards our total. Those are due by November the 19th. And then Reese Across America that you just saw the video about, they're $17 each. See Mr. Tommy. And even if you don't have someone to buy a wreath for, you can still donate to the cause because there's a lot of folks out there that need a wreath that may not have a family member to purchase it. So your money would go towards making sure that their grave had a wreath there for them. Any other announcements that I need to make this evening? December the 2nd at 2:30, downtown Gillsburg, the Christmas parade. So get that on your calendar if you don't already have it on there. December the 2nd at 2:30, the Christmas parade. We usually have some time on Sunday evening, so I'll tell you a story. As a farm credit lender and a guy that lends money on land, when we get someone approved, we have to go look at the land they're purchasing, okay? And kind of do our evaluation or appraisal of the land. So got this guy approved, and he was purchasing 80 acres in Jefferson Davis County. So I looked at the ownership map. I was like, man, it doesn't touch a road or anything. You got a way to get to it. We have to have access. The bank has to have access. The reasons for that, if we were to foreclose, we need to be able to get to it, okay? And he was like, oh, we're going to get an easement, cross my daddy's, blah, 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 blah. And I was like, okay, well, can I travel this easement in a truck? Oh, yeah, it's dry. It's drier than it's ever been. I was like, well, yeah, I'm sure it is. Well, I get out there Friday, approximately 1:30. I go down this 2-mile easement, and I come up on a creek flowing with beautiful, clear water. Just, I had never seen anything like it in the last 6 months. And I was like, dry, huh? So we're looking at it, me and my coworker, and he's like, I'm not doing it. I got new shoes on. I said, all right. So I look at it. I said, well, there's only one way to do this. So we park the truck. He stays at the truck. I get a running start. I'm holding my iPad because I have to take pictures with my iPad to get it, the pictures to go into our appraisal software. So I got my iPad, $1,500 iPad, and here I go. Whew. And believe it or not, even surprising myself, I cleared it. But I fail on the other end, on top of my iPad. Now, didn't break it. So I can tell you right now, they got at least a 300-pound resistance, the screen stick, okay? So then I walked the other 2 miles, and I'm already like, yeah, we can't finance this for this guy. He's going to do something different. But while I'm out here, since I drove all the way here, I'm going to go ahead and get pictures. So I take my pictures, blah, 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 come back. I said, okay, coworker, take this iPad. Toss him the iPad. I get back, I run and start, you know, I look at a few, I think that was my mistake, I looked at it too long. Get my run and start, and I jump. Now remember, I cleared it the first time. Well, I was about a foot short. Right into that nice, cold, clear water in the creek with my shoes and pants at approximately 1:30 on Friday afternoon. Now why I tell you all this? Because I had a loan closing on Friday afternoon at 4 o'clock at Wayne Dowdy's office. So I go up in there, wet pants, wet shoes, wet socks, you know. And so now I'm back on the whole health kick. I got to stop eating Little Debbie's. I got to stretch. Because even in your career as a banker, you may have to leap across a creek. There's got to be a sermon in there somewhere, right? So anyway, there you go. How about those youth this morning? Yeah, there's a few of them still here. They, listen, in all honesty, we appreciate Mr. Rodney for sticking around and helping us every Wednesday night. Yep. And we don't leave here until about 8:15, 8:30 every Wednesday night. So it is a sacrifice not only for him, but for the kids who can't drive, their parents sit out there or sit right here waiting on them for us to get done at 8:30 in the evening. And this is something that we're going to make a norm or make a habit. This is not just going to be sing one song and be done with it. Where you don't do away with habits. You need to replace bad habits with good ones. And that's what we're going to try to do here. So the youth still, we have two other songs we've been practicing on. And then we'll also be involved in some Christmas music come December. And what I would really like to see, I'll talk to all the important folks, but what I would really like to see is for them to incorporate some of their songs on Sunday evening in the new year, because maybe that will get their parents and grandparents here to watch them and get them here on Sunday evening. So that's going to be our plan going forward. But encourage them. I texted them a little bit this afternoon. Encourage them. With that, I think the next song is going to be better than the one we sang this morning, hopefully. And hey, I don't know. I've kind of gone off on a sermon here. I don't know. This is still your welcome and announcements. I don't know about a music director, music minister. I feel like that is something God will handle. God will send us the person. I know that from experience, being that guy in that grassy parking lot at Max Field that was asked, hey, do you want to cover the youth? That was 10 years ago. Okay, so I know God, how God will work in that. But the way I look at it is, if you ask someone if they're willing to come take this job or to do this, I know by experience the first thing you do is you get on and you check out their online service on the video. And we probably got a lot better opportunity of getting someone if it's packed back here behind us instead of just two or three women and five or six men. So that's kind of the whole thing. We say it's the youth choir mafia and we're taking it over. I don't want you to think we're kicking people out of the choir. No, we want to get them in here with everybody else and make this a success, make it a habit going forward and seeing what God will do through it, and hopefully make it a means of getting them here on Sunday evening. So that's my plan. Wanted you to know it so that you can, number one, could pray about it, and number two, encourage them, and come join the choir if you're not a part of the choir, because with that many numbers, we can do a lot more things when we have that. So please be in prayer about that. Think about that. Now, before I pray, I think we may get some rain tomorrow. I think we may get some rain Tuesday. I think we may get some rain Wednesday. I think Tuesday's going to be the real good day. Okay? Be in prayer about that if you haven't already. And hopefully we're blessed in that way. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then I'll turn it back over to Brother Ronnie. Father, we love you and we thank you. We just ask you now, Lord. We've had a little fun. We've laughed. We've taught. Well, we ask you now, Lord, to touch us, to prepare our hearts and minds for what you want us to hear tonight, Lord, how you want to speak to us tonight through Brother Vic, through song. We just pray, Lord, that everything we do here tonight, we do in a way that brings glory and honor to you. We just ask you to keep us safe while we worship. Keep us safe as we depart here, Lord. Just forgive us where we fail you. We thank you for the rain that we received. We ask for more rain. We ask that you be with those family members and church members who are going through illness, sickness, health-related problems. You will touch them. You will comfort them. That you'll help their family members, help them, give the wisdom, guidance, and knowledge to the medical personnel who are working on them as well. We just lift you up now, Lord. We turn this service over to you. We just ask you, forgive us where we fail you. We pray all this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Just to follow up on what Austin said, and Rodney can tell you this too, the more participants that we have in all of these programs, it makes it easier on everybody. It really does. And we have the talent here. We gave the, I hate to say elderly group, but the normal singers the morning off here, and I think they were surprised by that, but the youth certainly filled in and did their job, and we all appreciate this. I really did, too, for what you guys are working on, and I think it's great, because if we don't cultivate the younger group, we're not going to have anybody in the choir up here. It's just that simple. And they can do it. They can do it. There's a different perspective, and they'll tell you that when you're up here looking out. But it helps everybody out, and we all appreciate it. And whatever happens with a choir leader, a director, or whatever you want to call him, we'll certainly all be in prayer for that. But anything that we can do in the meantime, we need to do it. We have the people, we have the talent, and there's no reason why we shouldn't. What a great crowd tonight, Brother Vic. Evidently, you got them intrigued this morning, I guess is the best word I can come up with. We're going to close with our music with Trust and Obey, and we'll sing the first and fourth verses on that, and you can stay seated. Miss Carolyn. When we walk with the Lord, in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. Bid us do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He says we will go, never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you all for Thank you for helping, and we're glad Carolyn got here. She's had a busy afternoon, been working on school music, but she made it, and we're glad to see you here tonight. I don't know what to think about this. I don't know if some of you just want to see if I could finish a message, maybe. I don't know, but I hope that maybe these topics have been intriguing to you and causing you to do some thinking and studying about things. I forgot to mention on the way out this morning, I intended to miss it. By my count here, we have 10 shoeboxes left. So I need 10 volunteers. Don't make me say you, and you. But I have 10 boxes that need to go somewhere and get filled up, and we'll have our goal, Brenda, of 125 or more, maybe, since we don't know about the online boxes yet. But there's still 10 empty ones down here, so if you can do that, go ahead and take one and get them fixed up. All right, tonight I want us to pick up where we left off this morning. I'll share some other passages of Scripture with you along the way, but basically the same two passages of Scripture that we looked at this morning. I think John chapter 2, those two verses in John chapter 2, give us a really good basis for our thinking, because as I told you this morning, there are only four places in all the Scripture where the word, literal word, Antichrist, is used. That's in 1 John and 2 John. So you'll find those verses there, and we read a couple of them there this morning. So there are many more references, perhaps more than 100 passages in which some reference is made. But if we look at that basic passage again, 1 John chapter 2, just for the sake of time. John says, "Dear children, the last hour is here. You have heard that the Antichrist," and I think that is referring to a person, the person, "is coming. And already many such Antichrists have appeared. From this we know that the last hour has come." Now, it's my studied judgment that that second reference is to the fact that there are many others who have exhibited the spirit, if not the letter, of the Antichrist. For instance, we said this morning that there have been those that postulated that Hitler or Stalin or somebody of that nature was the Antichrist, and that is probably incorrect. That is, that's not true. But they did try. I mean, they exhibited that spirit, and you can say in that sense, they were like the second part of that passage of Scripture. So understanding that in that way, 100 other references that don't call him the Antichrist, but for instance, we read Daniel 8 this morning, and that passage is a valid one for us to use, and I called again your attention to those visionary chapters in the book of Daniel. Daniel is one of the least understood, I think, books in the Old Testament. One of the best books of prophecy, but one that is difficult to grasp. But if you can, and if we can get some sense from it, in Daniel's vision, there are those things that are there that are coming true and that are going to come true. But Daniel 8, which we read this morning, calls the Antichrist a fierce king, a master of intrigue. Now that name is catches my attention when I read that, because we don't think about this individual, the Antichrist, as being someone who would be a master of intrigue, but I think that is a very telling description of him. I think that's one we need to really look at. We need to grasp hold, and I think you'll see why in a minute here. Daniel 9 calls him the prince who is to come. Daniel 11 calls him a despicable man. Now, that's where it begins to get ugly, and we don't want to hear that sort of thing. But this is an ugly situation. This is not a nice individual. In the prophecy of Zechariah chapter 11, he's called another interesting name. He's called the worthless shepherd. The worthless shepherd. In 2 Thessalonians, he's called the lawless one. That fits. And he's also called the one who brings destruction. And you know, because most of us have looked at the book of Revelation on so many different occasions. In the book of Revelation, he's called the beast. the beast. So all of those things give to us a little different picture of these 100-odd passages in which, now let me tell you something interesting. Now that you know that, now that you know that there are 100 passages where the Antichrist is being referenced, you will start seeing them. You didn't really think about what, you didn't really know what it was when you read it, I would imagine, like me. And when you see them now, you say, oh, that's talking about the Antichrist. And all these different names, there are many different ones there. So let me just quickly run back over this morning just to set the stage for us, take just a minute to do that. We talked about first his appearing. When the Antichrist appears, the world is going to be in a terrible condition. It's going to be like the days of Noah, but I think it's going to be worse. It'll be very, very bad, to say the least. It's going to be a nasty condition on the face of the earth. The corruption of religion is going to be evident on the face of the earth. That's a startling one, a striking one, because we don't think about that happening or that sort of thing, but that's going to be the case according to God's word. And the only two things that are going to be holding the Antichrist back, the only two things that are holding him back right now, I think, or the completion of the church and the scripture. I mean, the Holy Spirit. The scripture says that those two things are powerful forces in this world. God has not completed his church yet. We live in an age of grace, and the church is still growing. The church, his bride, is still being added to. And I think once that moment comes, once that time comes, those two things are going to be one completed and second withdrawn. And I think that will allow the Antichrist to begin his despicable work on the face of the earth. So his appearing is an important thing. The second thing we talked about, his abilities. He's going to be a popular individual. We don't know who it is, but he's going to be a very, very pleasing individual. He's going to be a smooth-tongued, slick talker that people, I think, are going to be drawn to. They're going to gravitate to because of his ability, his orational ability. He's going to be one who promises peace. And I think at that point, things are going to be so bad that the world is going to be grasping at anything that can. Man of prosperity. I said this morning, it may very well be possible that this man will virtually eliminate world hunger and lack, want in our world. He's going to be one who will somehow cause a redistribution of wealth so that people who have never had anything will somehow now have some semblance of something, because this individual is going to control the world's wealth. And he's also going to be a man of power. Now, that being said, again, remember the last thing I told you this morning again, where does his power come from? Don't ever forget this. It's power from Satan. Power from Satan. Satan gives him a throne. Satan gives him a power, gives him authority. And that's why this is going to look so good, because Satan is the master counterfeiter, the master of intrigue, the master mocker, if you will. So that being said, thirdly, let me say, now this is the first two points. The third thing, first of all, these two things that we looked at this morning, his abilities last, and then thirdly, his actions. In Deuteronomy chapter 8, we read those verses this morning, verse 24 and 25. In Daniel chapter 8, we read those verses again this morning. He will become very strong, but not by his own power. And notice this phrase, he will cause a shocking amount of destruction and succeed in everything he does. Now, do you realize that we just said that he's going to be, like never before, destructive, and not only that, he's going to succeed in every bit of the destruction that he seeks to do? But that being said, let me tell you where that destruction is going to be directed more than anything else. He is going to attack the church as it stands. Why is that true? Because they're the people of God. He hates anything and everything to do with God and Christ. He hates the Jewish people. He will he will seek and set out to destroy them like nobody else. Hitler tried and did a pretty credible job there for a long period of time, but he didn't completely destroy them. Stalin and others have tried, but he is going, the Antichrist is going to finish the work, if he can, of Hitler and Stalin and others to do one thing, to destroy, to exterminate the Jewish people. That's why what we see happening today is so distressing and so troubling. It's one of those things, like you've heard this expression, well, it must be possible because it's being done. You know, and I think that's what, there are a lot of things in here that in this topic that fit that little phrase there. This spirit of Antichrist that John writes about, that we read in those verses a moment ago, has been with us for a long period of time, and we see these graphic examples. But what do we see again in our church today? We see the church being called intolerant. We must tolerate certain things. We must tolerate the alphabet folks, the LGBTQX, whatever they are this particular time. You and I are told that we must protect the spotted owl and the snail darter, but it's okay to abort a baby. What sense does that make? Nobody can make sense out of that. That absolutely is nonsensical, whatever. But we're also told we need to soften up. We need to loosen our stance. Don't speak evil of society. Some of you that follow the news closely, it was a news feed that came out, I think I got it yesterday, again, in one of our neighboring states, where one of the major worldwide denominations had suspended a bishop, a man, a highly placed man in that church. The reason being, he was conservative, and he has spoken out on many issues, and he was conservative in his views, and he has spoken out against some of the hierarchy of the church, and the church displaced him. They haven't decided yet what to do with him, but I suspect that from what I read, he's going to lose his position in the church altogether. But the anger and the abomination of the Antichrist is going to be systematic destruction, and this scripture says, and he's going to succeed at everything that he does, the church, the Jewish people, and on and on. Well, first he's going to attack the church. Then Daniel chapter 8 says he's going to even attack Christ. He's going to attack the Christ of God. Verse 25, he will be a master of deception, become arrogant, destroy many without warning. He will even take on the prince of princes in battle. Who is that but Christ? It's Christ. He hates him, and the Lord is going to, during that time, do something very interesting. Now, let me see if I can again establish a timeline. There's a lot of information right in here, and I chose to not deal with some of it in this particular section because there's so much volume to it. Maybe it would be better dealt with another time, and we'll think about doing that. But let me just see if I can throw one other thing at you right here, and you get your timeline. I told you this morning about the tribulation and the rapture of the church and the appearance of the Antichrist and the order there. During this particular time, I think it is worth noting here, when this master of intrigue, master of deception, the one who is arrogant enough that he's going to take on God, there's going to be an interesting thing that's going to occur. 144,000 young Jewish men are going to go like an army throughout the world and preach the gospel. And you will find this in the book of Revelation. This is much talked about in most any study of the book of Revelation. And you'll see that there. But I think one of the most interesting things about it, I know there are a lot of things that we could say, and that's why I said I'm going to stay from that for a moment here because of the sake of time. But one power that I can find that the Antichrist will not have is the power to thwart these 144,000 Jewish evangelists. That should give you and me hope. Because even in the midst of the greatest crisis that this world has ever seen and known, God is still in control. His hand is still going to be at work. He is still ultimately on the throne, even though this one who is against everything he has ever seen or heard, you and I can imagine about Christ or God or anything else, this one is not going to have power to stop these 144,000 evangelists who are going to go out and evangelize all over the world. Well, that being said, we'll leave that there. But let me call your attention to something else. When have you recently heard someone, and I hope you haven't, but most of you, if you've been around somewhere, when have you heard somebody take the Lord's name in vain? You don't have to answer that. You know, and I know it's pretty common. You don't have to go very far. It's everywhere. But let me ask you, how many times when you heard that, was it God or Jesus that they used? Or was it somebody else? How many of you have heard somebody supposedly use really bad cussing and use the word Allah instead of God? Usually it's God in a four-letter word, right? How many of you have heard somebody say Allah so-and-so? How many of you have heard Buddha so-and-so? How many of you Krishna so-and-so? You don't hear that. It's always God, and it's always Christ. You know why that is? Because Satan and his acolytes, the Antichrist, hate anything about God. They hate his very name. And that's what this scripture is teaching us that he's going to come to do, to discredit and demolish and destroy that wonderful name. Because when you and I and anybody else recognize his name, if we admit that he is who he is Lord, he died, he rose again, then he is Savior, and we must admit before him that we are sinful sinners, doomed to hell, and that nothing but the name of Jesus and his blood. If the word is right about him, and it is right, it must be right about everything else, and Satan and the Antichrist know that. If we recognize him as Savior and Lord, he points out our sin. And so he's not going to attack Buddha. He's not going to attack Krishna, nor Allah, nor anybody else that the world deems a god, if you will. He's going to attack Jesus, the Christ of God. So he's going to attack the people of God, the church. He's going to attack the Christ of God, his son here, the Prince of Princes, Daniel calls him. And thirdly, he's going to attack the center of God, the center of God. Let me give you a list of passages, and I think I have these just listed, the passages. This is a really second voluminous section right here, and we could spend an entire message or two talking about what these passages talk about. But let me give you the Daniel chapter 8, verse 25. Daniel 11, 36 and 37. Daniel 9, 27. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Matthew 24, 15. In these verses and in others similar to them, the Antichrist will now begin to show his true colors. These verses indicate that at a point of time, a specific point in time, the Antichrist is going to be revealed for who and what he really is. He's going to break. Remember we talked this morning about coming as a man of peace. He's going to be able to broker a peace deal with the nation of Israel for 7 years. In the midst of that, he's going to break that covenant. And the scripture is clear. You can find it in these passages and other references. The Antichrist is going to enter the temple in Jerusalem. He's going to enter the Holy of Holies. He's going to set up his throne there, and he's going to demand worship from the whole world. He's going to demand that the people of the world worship him. It will be then, and only then, that Daniel's vision will completely come true, because the people that realize that then will be those who are left, and they're going to see his abomination for what it really is. Daniel's vision, particularly in chapter 7. That's why it's important for you now to go and read 7, 8, and 9 in the book of Daniel. The Antichrist, according to the book of Daniel and alluded to in other places, the Antichrist is going to literally devour the world. That's the reference that they use there. In Daniel chapter 7, there's an interesting reference or two there. The Antichrist is going to do very much what others have done in form, particularly maybe someone like Hitler. The Antichrist is going to be slow and methodical. In Daniel chapter 7, it says he's going to persecute the world. The word literally means a slow wearing out, a slow grinding down. He's going to mercilessly, ruthlessly wear down the people of God. That's the saints who have come to Christ, who have come to God during the tribulation period. They're going to suffer a slow, torturous wearing out to destruction. That's the abomination of this one called Antichrist. So, in his appearing, in his abilities, in his actions, and there's a lot more information in those passages of Scripture. You can really get way out into prophecy there when you look at what's going to happen when he sets up his, reveals his true self. But the fourth thing that I want to say to you as we go is his afflictions. His afflictions. I think it's worthy of note again. He's going to be slow and methodical and cruel and relentless. And in these passages you will find, as you search them, the Antichrist is not going to enter the world with great fanfare. It's not going to be a big show, in other words, but he is going to little by little work himself into position with his smooth talk, with his good looks, and with his unrelenting power. Destructively beyond belief, he's going to set up his kingdom little by little. Revelation 13, John the Apostle says an interesting thing. He is going to be an individual from among the masses. Now, I said this morning that I might identify him for you. That's about as much as I can tell you. He's going to be, someone wrote, from the sea of common humanity. It's not going to be who you and I think. It's not going to be some individual that comes in with a great horde and a great throng and a great fanfare and everybody. This individual is there, and he's just going to slowly and methodically, because of the power of Satan, work himself into position and power. And these things are going to come to pass as Daniel saw and as John saw and as others have reported. I'll tell you one other interesting thing that I believe and I've come to believe. The Antichrist is going to be from a Gentile nation. Many have taught for a long time that he was coming from the Jewish descent. But I don't think so. I think there's some controversy here, and I know you can argue that, and some may. But the best evidence says that the Antichrist is going to come from a Gentile nation. He's going to attempt to change the moral and natural laws of the universe. We saw that in these passages that we read there. And in Daniel's vision and in John's reporting there, he's going to change the natural moral laws of the universe. Now, this is one of those things that it must be possible because it's been done, it's already happened. Let me just take you back to your history. During the French Revolution in the late 1700s, the French tried to do the same thing. In the early French Revolution, they tried to change everything that was affected in the natural laws of the universe by God and the church. They changed the church. They took the name church completely away. They made out like that word didn't even exist. They called churches something else. They changed the calendar. They changed the 7-day work week, the 7-day cycle that God himself ordained and instituted to a 10-day cycle. Imagine what that did. And so this is not only possible, it's been done before. But the Antichrist is going to change the natural cycles of things. Daniel chapter 8, and let's just look at this verse again. Daniel chapter 8, verse 25. Daniel 8, 25 says, he will be master of deception, become arrogant. He will destroy many without warning. He will even take on the princes, but he will be broken, though not by human power. Revelation 19, 20 says he's going to be judged by God. So at a point, he's going to be stopped. He will be broken, but not by human power. What else could break him but God himself? God is going to stop him. He's going to judge him suddenly, seriously. He's going to deal with him swiftly and harshly, and defeat is sure. Now, this vision that Daniel had of what was going to happen prior to this was so devastating to him that he literally became sick. And when he became well, he still couldn't understand all that he's seen. So don't feel poorly if with all of the overwhelming information that you can unearth like this, these 100 or so verses that reference him, if you feel the same way. But know this, God judged him. His defeat is sure. It's going to happen swiftly and harshly, and it's going to be serious. Revelation 19, 20, Revelation 20, 10. The scripture says there that he's going to be thrown, the Antichrist will be thrown into the lake of fire alive. And at the end of the millennium, at the end of the 1,000-year reign there, Satan himself is going to be judged and thrown into that same place. And the reference is that the Antichrist is still going to be there. The beast, the Antichrist, is still there. Revelation 20 will tell you that. So, in spite of his good looks, in spite of his smooth tone, in spite of his greatness and his power, in spite of all the wealth that he's going to be able to come to a point and control, in spite of all the fame, in spite of the fact that at one point in time, he is going to be ruler of the world, God is still in control. His word is still going out, and the Antichrist is going to be defeated. The scripture is clear. These verses, Revelation 19, 20, Revelation 20, 10, are both short verses. Not long at all. God's going to put a stop to it, and God's going to come in, and the Antichrist is going to be stopped. Now, let me see if I can sum up what I want to say to you about the Antichrist in a short statement. One of the reasons that I think is important, it's almost academic, that you and I know about the Antichrist. And the reason I say that is, I don't plan to be here. And I hope you don't either. You see, if this word is true, and if the way I understand it is correct, and I believe that it is first true more than anything else, whether I understand it correctly or not, I don't believe I'll be here. And I don't believe you will. And I don't believe any other Christian will. Because I think Jesus is going to come back and get us. So that's why I say it's almost academic. It's just for our educational thinking, because the real message of the Antichrist is you don't want to be here when he's here. You don't want to be in the horrible world that's going to be when the one who is against Christ comes to power. And the glorious truth, my message this morning and my message tonight, is that you don't have to be. Trusting Christ as your Savior and receiving him in repentance and faith in your heart secures for you a place in all of eternity. And when Jesus comes back, when he calls that roll some morning, the dead in Christ will rise and the church will be raptured to rise and meet him in the air. What a glorious eternity that promises us to be. The Antichrist will be in charge of the world in many respects at that point, and it'll be a horrible place. Thank you for coming back and sharing tonight. And I hope that this has stirred your thinking a little bit about this topic, and that maybe it stirred your heart, maybe to action if you need to take action, or maybe to be able to speak to someone who needs to trust Christ and to share with them about the terrible days that lie ahead and maybe not too far off. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you that it speaks to us, and for the way that it speaks, and for the power that it contains. And I pray that we'll not take it lightly. I pray that we'll not just blow these things off and say, well, I don't understand it, or I don't know, I just don't believe that's going to be that way. It doesn't really matter what I believe. It's what you've said, because what you've said is true and right and perfect, and it is inerrant and infallible in every respect. And so I thank you for that, and I thank you tonight that we can know that we know that we know that we know that you are in control, and that you provide for us a way of escape. You provide for us a home in heaven. You are preparing even at this moment now, and that on the authority of your promise that one day you are going to come back and return for your own. And you're going to call us, whether we've died and are resting in a grave somewhere, or whether we're still alive and we are gloriously caught up, snatched away from the hands of this abomination that's coming to this earth. We meet you in the air, where we shall be with you forever and forever. Oh, Father, we thank you for the precious promise. So help us to learn the lesson tonight of Antichrist. Help us to not be a part of anything that is that way. Help us not to go in that direction of this smooth talker who is even at work in these moments today in so many places, even in our churches today. We pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ. We pray for our fellow denominations, for those who have been deluded by Satan, who is so slick and who is able to do some of these things already now. We just pray that somehow they might come back to the truth, come back to their first love. They might realize that they are not only going in the wrong direction, but leading others in the wrong direction. Help us never to be a part of that. Help us to be followers of Christ, true and true in every way, and to follow you. Thank you now for these precious promises. And I pray that you might continue to speak to our hearts and make us a blessing to others. Make us a witness to others. Help us to be bold in these days that are ahead, that many might come to know you in repentance and faith. Bless us, we pray, and keep us safe now. In the matchless name of Christ and all his people said together in agreement, amen and amen. Thank you for being here. Good night. God bless you. Don't forget about our service next Sunday evening. Barbie Bassett will be here. And you'll not want to miss that service. It'll be one of our great ones this year. So come be a part. Good night. God bless you.